line of a cross. And this is not a long testimony. This is a popcorn testimony. You pop off and pop back down. And come here, we'll line up across the front. And I want to say, many times, the great miracles don't really happen during a fast. When Jesus was in his fast, he was under a demonic attack of Lucifer. And the miracles many times happen throughout the year. And it's all because you set the course of your year through fasting. I want you to introduce yourself, give us your name, and just in one sentence what God did for you.
My name is John Lees. Tuesday a week ago, when I came up for healing, and the Lord healed me of my acid reflux. Well, I've been off my medication since that day.
Praise God. Isn't that great?
Pat Harrell, right before the fast started even,
what God did for you? Just tell me what he did.
That's what he did. He gave me a breakthrough right at the very beginning of the fast, and everything just started revealing. And I've been on real strong heart medicine, but I went through the 21-day fast and only took a little bit of milk with that pill.
Praise
Didn't
God.
Even hurt.
Amen.
Hi, Pastor Bob. Deborah Myers, the Lord has healed my daughter and I are back in communication, and my brother, he was...
Broken relationship in your family. Isn't that great? Amen.
Pam Yancey, God opened my left ear.
He opened your left ear. How long have you been deaf in your...
Over 5 years.
5 years. God opened her ear. Hallelujah. Amen.
God's given me miracle healings, and he's given me desires in my heart about things. And I've been praying that the Lord would just cause people to come up and give me $20 bills. And I got two today from two different people.
Well, here, pray for me. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Hello. My name is Billy Hayes, and it was a healing in my body. It was my liver.
How long have you had a liver problem?
Well, I'm supposed to go for a biopsy, and I don't even want to go now. God told me to go on this 21-day fast, and so I canceled my, I've had a couple MRIs that the doctor wanted to do a biopsy.
But it's well now?
Yeah.
Isn't that great? Isn't that tremendous? Thank you.
My name is Vicki. I had a dream on the second night of the fast that my family had unclaimed money. And I went online. Went to unclaimedmoney.com, found my grandmother left over $1,000, and my mother's other mother left $800, and I got $138 for myself.
Praise God. Could you go on there and look for me? Amen.
Praise God. My name's Vonda Acosta, and during the fast, I've been out of work for a year, and I came to Louisville, and I have a job now.
Have a job. Amen.
My name is Della Kirk, and I was sitting over there during the revival with Ted Shuttlesworth. And during the service, I had an adjustment in both of my shoulders, snap, crackle, and pop going on, which was a healing. I wasn't even in prayer for it or anything. I had had an injury years ago, and it had healed up. I thought everything was okay. But during the service, I had this snap, crackle, and popping going on in both shoulders, and I knew that an adjustment was happening.
Isn't that great? Amen. Hallelujah.
The Lord took my husband and I all the way to California. My grandchildren, I have 7 grandchildren. They range from 12 to 16 years old, and every one of them are saved.
Hallelujah. Isn't that great?
Hi, I'm Amanda Grubb, and God has done so many amazing things this 21 days. He is really healing and restoring our marriage. We've had a really rough 1 year, and also he gave me an amazing, amazing job. So,
isn't that great? Amen.
That's it, Pastor Brian.
That's it. That's great. Isn't that wonderful?
My name is Jeff DeMuth, and God has blessed me with several unexpected financial blessings over the whole 21 days. It started the very first day. I've been unemployed since October, and God has also just increased my relationship with him, and I've had that time now, and I've had time to spend with God that I've never had before, and it's just a whole new relationship, and then, like I said, God has blessed us financially.
Isn't that great? Amen. Praise God.
Joshua Crowder, and the first few days of the fast, I was blessed with $50,000 scholarship for my first year at Northwestern.
Amen. Hallelujah. You know, Josh is a senior at Manual and got accepted at Northwestern. It's $58,000 a year to go to school. And during this fast, God gave him $50,000 scholarship. I think that is a tremendous testimony. Amen.
I'm going to be a grandmother in August, and they're getting married. That's good news. And Santa Hannah prophesied over me last Saturday that she saw gold coins dripping all over my head.
Well, praise God. I just claim that for you. Amen.
Keith Randolph, and I had a $32,000 debt that they called me and said, would you just pay us $10,000 and we'll write off the rest of it? And I didn't ask them to do it, and so I said, absolutely. And also today I have a third grandchild, which is a beautiful little daughter. This is not her. She's in the hospital right now. Just born, very healthy, and give God the glory.
Praise God. Isn't that wonderful?
God has been blessing me over the past year. Easter, I found out I was pregnant. God bought me a house, paid it off in cash. And the 28th, I was blessed with a healthy, beautiful baby boy, which is 25 days old.
Amen. Isn't that a beautiful little baby? Hallelujah.
Philip Woosley, and God healed me of cancer, and I thank you for all your prayers.
Amen. Our brother lives in Litchfield, Kentucky. And the first week of the fast, they put his picture up here on the board. And he came here to church in pain. And the preacher got up to preach. He said, somebody right over here is being healed of cancer. And actually, he pointed at two people, and both of them had cancer. He got up, came up here. He was slain in the spirit. All the pain is left, and the cancer is gone. I think we ought to give the Lord a praise clap for that. Amen. Hallelujah.
Okay. Dean Miller, the Lord brought about during this fast an unexpected raise at work with benefits that I wasn't really up for. And my cost of living where I live out of town got cut in half. We found a wonderful apartment. Have been staying in a motel, paying over $800 a month. Now it's $400 a month for that. And our marriage level and relationship and the spirituality has increased exponentially in our life.
Isn't that great? Amen. Hallelujah.
My name is Shannon Stevens, and I got healed from diabetes. I was taking Actos, 45 milligrams a day. I was also taking 2,000 milligrams of glucophage, and I was taking between...
How long have you been on the medication?
I've been on... Well, they've increased it over the years. I started being...
How long have you had diabetes?
2003.
2003. Totally healed. I think we ought to give the praise to God. Thank you. Hallelujah.
My name is Christian Lewis. I came to City of Hope on Monday, and just being around people during the fast that are fasting, you know, I fully surrendered my life to Christ and fully committed everything to Him. And within a matter of 6 days, you know, He's done a lot for me, and I can't bear to see what He's going to do for me in 6 months.
How long have you been on drugs?
Since I was 14.
14. So how long have you been clean now?
About 6 days.
6 days. And hallelujah. Place your hand out here towards Him. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, this was a great step for him to come. Now, Lord, I ask that you would not only clean his body, but you'd clean his mind. And you'd restore him to his family and to his folks. And you'd raise him up to be the man you've called him to be in the name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you. Hallelujah.
My name is Maxine Henderson. And ever since I've been fasting, God keeps showing me and showing me and showing me. And I just want to thank you all for praying for me. I've been having a problem with my heart. And my heart hasn't been bothering me anymore. And I've been bringing my grandkids. And my grandson wants to be baptized.
Isn't that great? How old's your grandson?
He's 10.
He's 10. Isn't this tremendous? Place your hands out here towards them. Father, I want to thank you for every one of these miracles. And Lord, it is a miracle. Lord, healing of homes, healing of lives, healing physically, financial blessings. Lord, you have brought breakthroughs. And I ask God that not only would they receive this, but they would give this away. And Lord, they would cross people's lives who need help. And what you've done for them, you flow through them and do for others in Jesus' name. Let's give the Lord a great big praise clap. Thank you. You may return to your seats. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Now tonight, we're going to receive our regular Sunday night offering. If you need an envelope, hold your hand up high. The ushers will serve you. And then Brother Mike Murdoch is going to minister. This is his fourth service. And we've worked him, and he's worked hard, I'll say that. And then at the conclusion of the message tonight, we're going to have an anointing service. And we're going to pray for everyone here. We're going to, Brother Murdoch is going to be praying. Our pastors are going to be praying. And then we are going to seal what God has done here. And we're going to release you to go home and eat. Hallelujah. Now, I feel like God dealt with me to go on for 100 days. I'm continuing the fast totally until later. I don't know how long I'll be able to go. But then I'm going on a partial fast. But I'm asking you here tonight to join with me in fasting for revival, because I believe something's going to break through. And when revival comes, it comes not just to the nation, but it comes to your family. It comes to your finances. It comes to your children. It's a life-changing experience. Louisville will be a better place because of what's happening now. And so I'm asking you to join with me. First of all, I'm asking you to join with me on fasting on Thursdays. And if you cannot fast the whole day, it fast at least until the evening meal. And that's good for everybody. But there will be tens of thousands of people around this country that are going to be fasting on Thursdays. And so Thursday is going to be your breakthrough day of the week. If you've been having a bad week on Thursdays, light is at the end of the tunnel on Thursday. Thursdays is going to be a great day to do business deals. It's going to just be, you are joining tens of thousands of people praying in this country on Thursday and are fasting. And then, in addition, I'm going to ask you, at least until Easter, to fast something else. I call it a trickle fast. It's a slow charge fast, and it may be fasting beef. It may be fasting pork. It may be fasting desserts. And somebody said, well, good, I'll fast bacon. I don't eat bacon anyway. Fast something that means something to you. And you just do that as unto God. And God will honor you for that in the name of the Lord. How many say, Pastor, I'm going to join you on this. Can I see your hand? Hold your hand up high. How many say, Pastor?
anything more powerful in your life than realizing singing to Him creates instant access to the spirit world. Singing is the corridor into His presence. It's crazy, huh? Raised in a preacher's home, never realized that the protocol for entering the world of the Spirit is singing to the Holy Spirit, not petitioning Him. And this is my favorite love song. I love sitting at your feet. I love hearing what you say. Can you give me more? I love knowing all your desires. I'm so pleasured to obey. Your favor is like a sunrise driving all my nights away. I love sitting at your feet every single day. Sing that last sentence with me, would you? I love sitting at your feet every single day. The Holy Spirit is not only a person, but He's a place. In Him we live, we move, we have our being. The Holy Spirit is a place. He's not only a person, but He literally is a place. We live, we move, we have our being in Him. He is much more than a prayer language, much more than an invisible power in the Christian's life. He knows everything. Job 33:4 calls Him the Spirit of Life. He's the one that created humans. Job 26:13 said He decided the shape of all the animals. Isaiah 11:1 and 2 calls Him the Spirit of Knowledge. Ephesians 1:17 calls Him the Spirit of Wisdom. Jesus referenced Him in John 15 as the Spirit of Truth. He is the only person you're required to obey. You instantly know when He's unhappy, when you're unhappy, because it's in His presence that there's fullness of joy. The average believer has never learned to discuss everything with Him, everything. I love sitting at your feet. Pull your Bible up close. I love hearing what you say. I love knowing your desires. Try it with me. I love knowing your desires. I'm so pleasured to obey. I'm so pleasured to obey. Your favor is like sunrise. Your favor is like sunrise. Driving all my nights away. All my nights away. I love sitting at your feet every single day. Sing that last sentence. I love sitting at your feet every single day. Repeat this prayer with me. Precious Holy Spirit, You are my master mentor. You're my trusted teacher. I love Your voice. I'm addicted to Your presence. When You speak, I answer. When You instruct me, I obey. Tonight, I am a receiver of Your blessing, of Your goodness, of Your wisdom, of Your knowledge. Tonight, I embrace your assignment for my life. I am willing to be corrected, instructed. Your will shall be accomplished in my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Say, I'm a receiver. Say it again, I am a receiver. Praise the Lord. Well, I hope this is on here. We'll see here shortly. And I really wanted to sing a couple of love songs to him. If you ever learn to sing love songs to the Holy Spirit, it changes your world. There is nobody. There's nobody like you. There's nobody. There's nobody like you. Sweet Holy Spirit, sweet Holy Spirit, there is nobody, there's nobody like you. Nobody else, Holy Spirit, does what you do. Nobody else, Holy Spirit, does what you do. Never take your place. Turn my life around through saving grace. Nobody else, Holy Spirit. Nobody else, Holy Spirit, does what you do. When I'm in your presence, I always change. I'm just not the same. I am just not the same. When I'm in your presence, Holy Spirit, I always change. And I can't go back to yesterday again. I'm in love. 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 Sweet Holy Spirit, I'm in love. I'm in love, I'm in love, I'm in love. Sweet Holy Spirit, I'm in love. I'm building my life. I'm building all my dreams around you. I'm building my whole life. I'm building all my dreams around you. I want to spend all the rest of my days living in your presence, in my secret place. I'm building my whole life, building all my dreams, Holy Spirit. Around you.
had a company I was doing business with. There's a great difference between Christian ministry and Christian business. A profound difference. I didn't know that when I started off in the ministry. But there's Christian businesses that make money off of Christians. They're Christian business. They're not really Christian ministry. And so this company had done me wrong. Just dead wrong. We agreed that I would, they would print my books and they would sell them to other companies for X amount, and I would get a percentage of royalties. And they created, I was sharing with Pastor tonight before church, they created another company within their company. So instead of me making a dollar on a book or 75 cents on a book, they sold it to themselves, and I made like 2 cents. And so I was kind of angry, to put it mildly. So one night on the plane, the man behind me was a famous lawyer. Everybody had been all over the papers. And when we got off the plane, he said, "If you ever need me for anything, Brother Mike, let me know." I said, "As a matter of fact, brother, I do." I said, "There's a company in Tulsa, Oklahoma that's done me very dirty. And I'm going to need some help." And so a few days later, I was kind of excited. I sort of felt like God had matched us together, you know, on the same plane. How often would that happen? And he was known to win his cases, and he was quite excited about going off after these people for me, and I thought that was the Lord. And so a few days later, I'm in the secret place, and suddenly this song came to me. "I will do things your way. I will do things your way. When you speak, Holy Spirit, I'll obey. Oh, I will do things. Oh, I will do things. Oh, I will do things your way." I called the president of the company. It took me 4 months and 4 phone calls to get him to fly to Dallas. I said, "I want you to come spend some time with me in the secret place. If you can't get your son in the secret place, he'll never change anywhere else. If you can't get your daughter into the presence of God, you're absurd to put him anywhere else. The presence of God is the only place we can change. We can adapt and adopt behavior that deceives others, but his presence is where your nature changes." And at the end of 4 hours of praying together, I looked at him, I said, "You know, you did me very dirty." He said, "I am so sorry." And he wrote me a check to make up for that. And I didn't have to pay a lawyer a penny. "I will do things your way." Don't you love that? "I will do things your way. When you speak, Holy Spirit, I'll swiftly obey. Oh, your way." The first experience I had with false accusation was devastating to me. Devastating. My mother had emphasized a good name is better to be chosen than great riches. So when I had my first false accusation, I went a little crazy. I thought I would go nuts. I went through the devil part where you want to find this person and deal straight. How many would like to backslide, like for one day, to catch up with a lot of people? How many understand that? I mean, I was just angry. That's because you can't prove what you didn't do, that you didn't do it. I called. I was just ferocious. What can you say? What can you do? And I called Brother Oral Roberts, and he started laughing about 2 minutes into my conversation, he said, Mike, I just want to know, did they spell your name correctly? Then I went to my father, and Daddy said, son, just keep doing what God's anointed you to do. Don't look to the right or to the left. Do not answer your critics. Don't do anything. Just stay focused. Stay focused. Stay focused. Stay focused. There's going to be parts of your journey you never anticipated. There's going to be parts of the journey that is so devastating to your spirit that people that you've invested the most in seem to turn their back on you. I find that people that receive the most are the most unthankful, most ungrateful. And I've had to go back to the heart of God. God never called me to understand people. He never called me to change people. He only called me to anoint, for love, to love people. Say, I'm anointed to love. Say, I'm not anointed to change anybody. I'm not anointed to understand anybody. I'm only anointed to love. And the Holy Spirit began to deal so strongly with me. I never dreamed in my beginning years that I would have to face things that I have faced. Never dreamed it. Never anticipated the unexpected war. But this little song here is really my heart. I love sitting at your feet. I love hearing what you say. I love knowing all your desires. I'm so pleasured to obey. Your favor is like a sunrise, driving nights away. I love sitting at your feet every single day. I love sitting at your feet every single day. Oh, don't you love it? Don't you love it? Lift your right hand high and say, I'm a receiver of every good and perfect gift. Say it again, I am a receiver. God's looking for receivers. Took me years before I realized the Bible is a book about receiving. God told Adam, I want you to receive. I want you to receive. I want you to receive a garden. Then he said, I want you to receive a wife. John 1 and 11 and 12, he said he came to his own, but his own received him not. You don't have what God gave you. You only have what you're willing to receive. God's given much that's never been received. Look how many people he loves on the earth that didn't receive his love. So you don't have everything God gave you. You have what you were willing to receive. So I ask the Holy Spirit, make me skilled at receiving. I've been good at sowing, but I hadn't been great at reaping. How many is good at sowing, but you'd like to learn how to receive? There's a little girl, just turned 13 years old. She's a sweetheart. When she was a year old, year and a half, I dated her mother for a season, and they stayed friends and still close to my life as people and friends. But she'll text me, where are you? I miss you. And she just turned 13. She is the most skilled receiver I have ever met in my life. She's profoundly good. If you don't get good at receiving, you're going to have one sloppy life. She likes pink. So I buy her pink everywhere, everything. I buy her pink constantly. She likes pink TV, so I get a pink TV. She likes pink luggage. She didn't have an iPad, so I bought an iPad with a pink cover from Apple. iPod, pink. Everything I can find, every time I see pink. Because this is how she responds. Every time, how did you know? This was just what I've been wanting. I'm very trained. Very trained. You and I know that we live by reactions. Reactions decide the quality of your marriage. Reactions decide your salary, your reaction to a problem, your reaction to an instruction. And that's the purpose of wisdom. We talked about this morning that wisdom is the ability to recognize difference. Difference in people, difference in an environment, difference in a moment, difference in an opportunity, difference in a countenance. When Joseph saw the countenance of the butler and the baker, he saw a problem. And everywhere there's a problem, there's a future. Everywhere there's a problem, there's potential. Until there's a problem, you're unnecessary. Until somebody has a problem, you're unnecessary to them. And when Joseph saw the countenance of the butler and the baker, he reacted to the countenance, I see a problem. And a problem is an invitation to reveal your competence, your compassion. Until there's a problem, there is no reward system. The entire kingdom runs by a reward system. So we are created and assigned to do problem solving. So my reaction to a problem determines my future. The dominant fruit of wisdom is to identify who we should honor. If you treat everybody the same, then nobody is honored. But we know that when we have the wisdom of God, we begin to discern difference in others. And the purpose of discerning that difference is to reward them with honor. What is wisdom? The ability to anticipate a consequence, the ability to recognize difference. Right and wrong. Proverbs 2, 4, 5, 6, 12, and 16. And when there is wisdom of God in our life, we begin to look for difference. I listen for difference in a conversation. I look for difference in a countenance. Study difference. We listen for difference. And the purpose of that is to identify the proper reaction to this person. I see difference. I told my mother, she had 9 children, 7 of us lived. I said, Mama, talk to me about raising children. She said, well, first, every one of them are different. And she said, sometimes one just requires a look and they get in line. Another one requires a belt and they get in line. I wish I'd have known that. I didn't know about child abuse centers at that age. We have a number of books. I've written 320. And if you follow me on Twitter, it's worthy, by the way. There's some profound, profound truths linked all over the world to people who follow me on Twitter. And if you follow me on Twitter, you can have the Tweeter's Handbook for a dollar bill. It's just our way of acknowledging. It's a $10 book. If you don't follow me on Twitter and you try to get one for a dollar, you will have 3 flats on your car by the time you get out of the driveway. I want you to have that. It's very powerful. Anyone that invests $20 or more into the wisdom of God will give you this absolutely free as our gift to you. 1001 Wisdom Keys of Mike Murdoch has 52 study guides, over 100 personal pictures of our ministry. It's very powerful. There's no book like it in the world, and you cannot buy it in a bookstore. It's our way of honoring you for loving the wisdom of God. I'll invest everything in my mind. My mind is more important than my house. My mind is more important than my father. If I don't take care of my mind, I can't take care of my father. We talked about the law of the mind, that your mind needs a focus, it needs constant conversation, and your mind needs a hero. If you can manage your mind, you can manage a day. When you can manage a day, you have managed your life, because today is the only place you'll ever be. When you arrive at tomorrow, you will rename it today. So if you can't make 24 hours go right, how could you make 24 years go right? Tonight I want to talk to you about things that matter most. We talked about the wisdom being the ability to perceive, discern, recognize difference in people. Their difference from you, recognizing your difference from others. That if you cannot tell me your difference from others in a sentence, you haven't discovered it. If you waste your time studying your weakness, you'll never discover your difference. God loves different. God loves new. He said, even my mercies are new every morning. I saw a book in a bookstore some months ago, Real Men Hate Shopping. That's when I discovered I was half woman. I had no idea that I was half woman till I saw that book. I like shopping. God loves new. I actually think heaven's going to be a mall. That's my personal persuasion. It better not be like church. My hair is important, but it's not important as my fingers. My fingers are important, but not as important as my eyes. My eyes are important, but not as important as my blood system. So when we talk about wisdom, somebody says, I need wisdom. They say, I need to see the distinction. I need to see the difference. I need to be able to anticipate the outcome. If I have wisdom, it means I see the difference in value. Everything has a different value relative to time. If I tell you I had to pay $50 for a gallon of gas, you say, you must be an idiot. But if I told you I was out on the desert and nobody was there except one man with 1 gallon, you say, oh. At some of our seminars, we'll have people said, if I was to give you $1 million to jump out of an airplane, would you do it? Everybody, no, 2 million. I'd get up to 10 million. No, I wouldn't jump out of a plane for $10 million. And then I say, if I told you it was on the ground, would that make a difference? Yeah, that'd make a difference. There's always missing information. That's why you make mistakes. You change the equation. You change the outcome. I want to talk to you about some things that matter most. Matter most. Matter most. Number one is singing to the Holy Spirit. It really matters to sing to the Holy Spirit. You don't enter His presence every morning with a to-do list. Good morning, Holy Spirit. Here's your top 10 things to do. We're not in His presence to give Him instructions. We're in His presence to receive instructions. When you sing, He enters. Is that vital? It took me months to settle a deal to buy some real estate, months. And the old man who owned it didn't like me, I guess, but he made it hard, no concessions. And before I went to sign the papers, I'm in the secret place, I'm singing to the Holy Spirit, and I said, I don't feel good about this real estate. He said, I'm not in the transaction. I said, what do you mean you're not in the transaction? He said, this is not my deal. I said, but you said the desire of the righteous shall be granted, and I want it. And the Holy Spirit says, this man doesn't like you. There's no favor. You're the only one that's done all the you're the only one that's done all the adaptation. He's made no concessions. And he reminded me that God talks, it's four distinct ways, but God talks through favor. Wherever there's favor, there's divine future. I always look for spots and roads of favor. Wherever there's favor, God is there. I said, well, now it's late. I've already told her. I just said, Holy Spirit, stop it. Somehow just stop this deal. And just when we got there, the realtor said, Brother Mike, I hate to tell you this, but he has asked one more thing. And he says, this man's made it so hard for you, but he said, if you don't do this, he will not sell you the land. I said, really? A few months later, I get in a business transaction. I'm in a real estate transaction. And there is favor, north, south, east, west. I was wallowing in favor. And God gave me the plan, called him, said, you have 2 hours to accept my deal. And 2 hours later, I added $4 million to my profit. $4 million in a day. That's all right. I've adjusted to your jealousy this morning. I adapted. Now, where I come from, Louisiana, $4 million in a day is wonderful. I can tell that's not good here in Louisville, but if you knew where I came from, me and Jesse Duplan is raised in the same environment, Louisiana. Dad used to spend the night at our house. We're still stunned that Jesse is a Christian, but he is. He actually is. But you stay where there's favor. Well, who teaches you that? The Holy Spirit. He's a master conversationalist, the least boring friend you have. He requires the least and deposits the most. Never misinterpret you. He is possibly one of the few friends in your life that will never make an inappropriate request. He is acquainted with your history of your wounds. He interprets your reactions accurately. I never have to adjust. He understands me. And that's incredibly pleasurable. To be in someone's presence that requires no explanations. If you never do anything else with your life, come into his presence at the same time every day. Because routine is a road to a future. The difference in the successful life and the failure is routine. God established routine to take you anywhere you want to go. You come into his presence at the same time every day. Invest the first 7 minutes. Why seven? I use my energy to get into his presence and let him use his to keep me there. I enter to his presence singing, I love you, I love you, Holy Spirit. I love you, Holy Spirit. And when the devil says, you forgot to buy milk for breakfast, you say, thanks, devil, and you write what he reminds you about. He's your little memo pad. Took me a half a century to discover God keeps using everything that's broken. God has kept using Satan. And if God's going to use the devil, you might as well use him too. He is your memo pad. You say, I love you, Holy Spirit. He says, you forgot to call Bill back. Thank you, devil. You forgot to fill up with gas. Thank you. On day three, he will never remind you of anything again. It's almost like it agitates him. Things that matter most, singing to the Holy Spirit. I sing to him in planes. I sing to him everywhere. Number two, second thing that matters most is reactions. You don't have 10 years to know somebody. I study the Bible to know God, but I study reactions to know people. What is your reaction to correction? What is your reaction to an instruction? Let's suppose I have three of my men that travel with me tonight, and let's say that my three men, and they're three of my favorites, let's just say assistant number one, I say, I sure would love some carrot juice, because I like carrot juice. And assistant number one says, me too. I wish I had some too, Brother Mike. Assistant number two says, well, Brother Mike, if I had some carrots, I'd sure make you some. Assistant number three says, he likes carrot juice. I'll be right back. He comes back to me. There's a carrot. Would you like it twice a day, once a day? Would you like an apple? And how would you like it? When I get ready to get on a plane, which one of these three do you think I want with me? Number one, right? Because he likes carrot juice too. Oh, not number one? Number two, right? Because he said if anybody get him a blender and some carrots, he would make me some. Which out of the three? Three, you smart. You're smart. Three, you're very smart. Smart? Your salary is not determined by your gift. Your salary is determined by the problem you solve with it. So your reaction to an instruction determines your financial future. There's no mystery to favor. There's no mystery to favor. Oh, I want favor. You really think that's a miracle? Everywhere there was favor, there was a problem solved. When Joseph solved problems, favor was a reaction. Favor is a reaction to when you solve a problem. You have to sow favor to reap favor. You can't sow one seed of favor and expect 1,000. Favor is proportionate. Problem solving, I see. Okay. What is your reaction to the presence of God? Young lady said, Dr. Mike, I want you to meet my boyfriend. How would I know? I said, what is his reaction to the presence of God? Because it's the only place he'll change. What's his reaction to presence of greatness? When you're at a meal with someone who is an uncommon achiever, the smartest man I ever knew, and I would give up anything to have conversations with him. Every time he'd come once a year through Dallas, he had a $12 million home, and he was just incredibly successful, but so smart. He said, never be in the presence of greatness without reacting appropriately to it. I said, what do you mean? He said, let's just say Michael Jordan, the famous basketball player, is in a restaurant. Either pick up his tab or write him a note. Thank you for your gift. He said, never be in the presence of greatness without showing honor. What's your reaction to a mistake? For years, I couldn't find an armor bearer who would buy a map. And I would pay for it. I hate being lost. If I'm in the car with somebody and they get lost, it's almost like they become a devil. They're the Antichrist. I almost could write a book on who the Antichrist is when I get in the car of somebody. I hate it. How many hate being lost? And if you've got a husband tonight that would rather drive around for 2 hours than stop and buy a map, you better stay in church. Because church is going to be the only place you're going to be able to survive him. There's nothing like having somebody drive around for 2 hours. And so finally I told a young man, I said, son, we're lost, aren't we? And I was busy calling, talking. He said, I said, didn't I tell you to stop him? Didn't I tell you? How many times am I going to have to tell you to buy a map? I've told you this. And he starts saying, well, what I said, son, I don't want to hear the reason you're stupid. I want you to stop right over here and buy a map. I said, son, don't get mad. Be thrilled. I didn't hit you and go to jail, start a new TV ministry or prison ministry. I said, I could have hit you. What is your reaction? What is your reaction to your own mistakes? If I study your what's your reaction to a gift? I bought somebody a car a few weeks ago, and this was their reaction. Praise God. I've been telling God, oh, thank you, God. I said, God, nothing. I'm the one that gave it to you. You've served God 20 years. He never bought you a car. Don't get a gift from me and then thank God. Some of you, Pastor, you'll have to correct that and straighten it out for somebody, I know. I gave somebody something one time. They said, it's about time I get a harvest. What is your reaction to a gift? I already have one like this. I don't like this color tie. How do you respond to the gift of access? How do you react? Your reactions have created the quality of your marriage. Your reactions create everything in your life. Reactions matter. It decides, and you that are watching there at your home through television or the streaming live, you need to grasp this. If you fail, it'll be because of your reaction. If you succeed, it'll be because of your reaction. You got time for two more? Everybody's got 5 more minutes. You got 5 more minutes? 5, 10, 15, 20, 25. All right, all right. Let's see. Write this down. Favor. Favor matters. Treasure favor. Protect the streams of favor that are shown to you. Don't assume you qualify for all the favor. Don't assume that when somebody is good to you. I had a man tell me just a few hours ago something kind of electrifying. He said, do you realize that the blessing of the Lord is continuing on you because of your father's intercession? Do you realize that the impact of your father's prayers are still at work for you? That years after his passing, the blessing of the Lord continues because God, he had favor with God. How do you react to the door of favor? How many's ever let somebody in on the freeway that was trying to get, and you said, you go first? How many's ever let somebody else go first? How many's ever had them ignore you after you let them go first? And they acted like they got one over on you. Now, I have the nature that when I see somebody trying to cut in line, there's something in me that says, oh, yeah? Oh, yeah? How many's got a stupid part of you that just emerges occasionally? Don't ever, ever, ever take favor lightly. Whether it's access to have a meal with someone, someone picks up the tab. And you say, well, they should. They have more money. Oh, sowing up creates as much blessing as sowing down. Ezekiel 44. Wherever there's been favor in your life, I was stunned to find that people that I did the most for at the Wisdom Center were the first ones to find a church across town. Now, Pastor, you already know this, but I'm just learning. If I made a car note for them, it wouldn't be 4 months. Then the guilt would overwhelm them. Because it's hard to stay in the presence of somebody you owe. And the only way for payback is gratitude, service. And when somebody has no gratitude, they can't reimburse you. And just let me just say this, that reimbursement is the first reaction to repentance.
A man owed me thousands of dollars, and somebody came to him and said, "He's changed. He's back in church." I said, "He hadn't changed a lick." "How do you know?" I said, "He's never paid me back." First thing that Zacchaeus wanted to do is, "I've got to pay back four times what somebody owes me." The passion to reimburse, to equalize favor, is the character of God. He said, even a thief, when he is found, he has to pay back seven times. If somebody owes you money and you found out they're serving God now and they're in church, you'll know if you get a letter from them saying, "I owe you. I'm sorry." What is your response to favor? Are you a receiver, a gracious receiver? A lady from my church went to get in the car one night, and I sent the young man with me. I said, "Would you go open a car door for me? And he went to open the door, and she lashed out, "I can open my own car door." I walked over there and said, "Now, you're the exact reason I'm preaching this message on the art of receiving." How do you receive favor? How do you receive until you master receiving? Well, Mike, which comes first, giving or receiving? Obviously, receiving. How can you give if you hadn't got? Everybody say 1, 2, 3, duh. 1, 2, 3. If you don't know how to receive, you'll never have anything to give. Receiving comes first. I have nothing to give until I learn to receive. Freely I've received, now I can freely give. That's why you want to get good at receiving. If you want to become a PhD in sowing, become good at receiving. I love my little nano watch. I really like it because it's got 2,000 songs on it. It's got the whole Bible on it, and I can it's kind of nice. And so when I found out about the other night, I had about 14, 15 people at my house. And so when I said, "Oh, I love that. Let's get everybody one." And so I sent a young man to the Apple store so everybody could have a nano watch. And one young man says, I'm not a taker. I looked at everybody and said, "Do you see what he just called you? He called you a taker." He said, "Well, I don't want to take the gift." I said, "Now, son, there's so much for you to learn. It has nothing to do with taking." You could have said, "Thank you, Dr. Mike. Thank you. Thank you for that gift. Thank you for blessing me. Pastor, I've traveled many thousands of miles, you know, many, many countries. And I've had preacher's kids come in there. And I used to give all the preacher's kids, everywhere I went, I'd give a $100 bill because I really like $100 bills. There's something about a $100 bill just from God. This lady that's excited over a $20 bill, that's a marvelous place to be. But I like $100 bills. I've been all over the world. Been to Cairo, Egypt, seen the pyramids, been to the Holy Land. I hadn't seen anything as beautiful as a $100 bill. I hadn't seen a woman as good looking as a $100 bill. There's just something supernatural about that $100 bill. How did I get off on that? I have no idea how I got off on that. I begin to discover that responding and receiving and learning how to receive, your response to gift number one determines if you get gift number two. Pastor said, "Son, my brother Mike, this is my son." And his son would, "This is my daughter. Hi." And I'd think, "Lord, he doesn't need a devil. When you got a stupid child, you don't need a devil. You made it." Then I'd go to another church, and the pastor would say, "I want you to meet my son." And the little boy would walk over there. "We're so happy to have you. Your message was good tonight. Your sermon was good tonight." The little girl comes in. "Hi, Dr. Murdoch. My name is Jill. Thank you for coming to our church." Unthankfulness is an odor. It's in an environment. I walk in your house and see if I can feel gratitude. It's so thick. And wherever there's thankfulness, wherever there's thankfulness, there is favor. And where there's favor, there's always money. Everywhere there is gratitude, everywhere there is thankfulness, there is favor. And everywhere there's favor, financial blessing is there. Hallelujah. Write this down. Things that matter most. Expectation. Expectation. Expectation is an environment. It's in an atmosphere. I drove up to Home Depot some months ago, and some little girls, you know, these little Girl Scouts organization, they had a bunch of cookies out there. And I think they were $2 each or something like that. And they just rushed up. Oh, man. The excitement on their little face. 9, 10, 11, 12. Hi. How many cookies would you like? Wow. I bought loads of cookies. I don't even eat cookies. But their excitement, their expectation did something to me. Now, if you ever go to a little boy scout table, little boys are totally different. They walk up grunting. You don't want any cookies, do you? Good night. I gave all the cookies to my staff. I didn't eat them. But their expectation was electrifying. I can walk into a room and feel expectation. This was the secret of the harvest from our seed. Now, I have a real revelation on the seed. Like the preacher in Chicago said, if you want a debt-free home, plant a seed equal to your monthly mortgage payment. Right on there, debt-free house in 12 months. Hold it in your left hand and slap it 3 times. In 8 months, my house was debt-free. I was preaching for a friend of mine in Columbus, Georgia. Rod Parsley, and I had just received a check for $8,500, and I was excited. And while I was teaching, the Holy Spirit said, how would you like to explore and experiment what I could do with your $8,500? And I said back to him, I'm happy with the $8,500. Bird in the hand's worth two in the bush, you know. He comes back again, how would you like to explore and experiment what I could do with your $8,500? Then it realized, my dreams were bigger than $8,500. $8,500's not enough to have a parade over. Gave the whole $8,500. 6 weeks later, at 7:15 a.m. on a Tuesday morning in Houston, God gave me an idea. I called a business friend of mine. I said, God gave me the idea. He said, let me take it, and I'll put it in the stores, and I'll give you a royalty check every 90 days. He signed contracts with Walmart, Kmart, Hallmark. My first royalty check built me a gymnasium at my house. My second royalty check 90 days later bought me a beautiful Rolls Royce, cash. One man says, I don't like Rolls Royces. I said, that's why it's at my house. What did Jesus, when he looked at Peter in Mark 10 and says, anything you give up for me will come back to you 100-fold. What was he doing? He was building his expectation. The widow of Zarephath Elijah said, would you give me one of your pancakes? She said, I don't have enough for you. Did he say, God's going to hold you responsible? If I have to go off TV, you're going to be the phone. No. Elijah looks at her and he starts painting a picture. The cruse of oil will not fail. The meal barrel will not run dry. Did you tell me today, I can't wait to hear your message on it, 18 years later, she was still reaping from that seed. 18 years later. Expectation. It's not enough to sow. It's not enough to sow. God put expectation in the equation. That's what makes it work. Otherwise, a rich man could buy God, and a poor man has no future. God put in the expectation. He that cometh unto him must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder. Without faith, it's impossible to pleasure the heart of God. God has one craving, and that's the craving to be trusted. When he's trusted, he never forgets it. Expectation. 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 I was sitting with Oral Roberts, me and my father, for lunch one day in Dallas, and God said, give him $25,000. And I thought, wow, I have intercepted a message God was telling Brother Roberts to give me $25,000. I just sat there, I couldn't hardly believe it. Oh, my Lord. Hour and a half later, he's holding my seed for $25,000. In 3 days, 72 hours from that uncommon seed, heaven opened. Man sent me a video, happy birthday to you, went outside, and there was his gift to me, a brand new black Corvette. A few weeks later, a woman drove up to the Wisdom Center and said, God told me to give you my Corvette. A few months later, I pulled in my house, and there's another brand new Corvette, a yellow convertible Corvette from a friend. Then I get a phone call as I was walking out of a hotel, and a friend said, have you seen the 745 BMW? I said, yes. He said, how would you like one? I said, oh, brother, I don't need that. I don't even like to drive. But it arrived 2 weeks later straight from Germany. Then a 750. Then a few months ago, phone rang, said, go around the corner, and there's about 15 minutes away, and they're backing off a brand new, was it a 500 SEL, Mercedes, whatever it is, backed it off, and he said, my goal is to give you a new car every year for the rest of your life. Pastor, if I were you, I would always stay over here in this section, because right over here, there's some deep resentment. I work with my expectations. God said, I want you to expect largely from me. Expect largely. You have any idea how much God longs to bless us? I've been single 33 years. One night, I was looking through a magazine, and I saw this beautiful fur coat on a woman. I said, wow, it'd be nice to have a wife to buy that for. Then I turned the page. There was some jade jewelry necklace hanging all over the... I said, wow, I like that necklace. It'd be nice to have a wife to buy that for. And the Holy Spirit suddenly smote me. He said, now you know how I feel. I have a whole universe to give away to someone who will expect from me. He said, if you give him a hand clap, he is our God. He is a Jehovah Jireh. He said, if you being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more your heavenly Father. I get ecstatic when people I love find something they like. One of my sisters was, she says, oh, Mike, I found a Corvette, and I'm going to drive several hours. She lives next door, her and her husband, to me. I said, sis, I didn't know you liked a Corvette. Oh, it's been my dream. I said, oh, sis, live right next door to me and never told me you loved Corvettes? I reached inside my little blessing stuff, pulled out some stack of money. I said, you get exactly which one you want. I'm so ecstatic that you found. Then my other sister said, there's another Corvette there. She ended up with the Hummer. I was praying one day and it dawned on me that one of my baby sisters may have never chosen a dream home, because every brother should buy his sister a home. If you're worth a dime as a brother, you'll buy your sister a home. And I called her, I said, sis, I said, have you and Robert, her husband, have y'all ever seen a dream house? Oh yeah, there's one up here on the lake. I said, she said, it's gorgeous. I said, how much does it cost? She said, oh, we've never asked. You know, it's on the lake. That's preacher kid talk, for I'm too poor to ask the price. In 30 days, she was in that house, the house debt-free, the deed given to her to retire on that gorgeous home. Now, if we, being evil, love to give, how much more does our Heavenly Father want to give to us? How much more? How much more? If you understood the character of God, that's what prosperity is all about. Prosperity is not having 3 suits, a new car. Prosperity is living in covenant with someone who's excited when they can excite you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When my father was 80, he's 95. When he was 80, I took him. We was preaching in Italy. And I said, Daddy had never been to Israel. And I said, let's just zip over there. And I just, he had never been there. So I hired a guy and we went everywhere. And we're in a store and he's stroking a briefcase. He loves briefcases. And I walked up. And I said, Daddy, you already have 15, 20 briefcases. He said, uh-huh. But he said, I've never had one like this. And I'm sitting there thinking, hey, you're 80. You're not even flying around everywhere. How are you going to need a briefcase? When are you going to need a briefcase? Then it dawned on me. He doesn't go to casinos. He doesn't smoke. Doesn't cuss. Doesn't drink. He's worth an extra briefcase. Do you think I would let my father walk out of that store without something that brought joy to his countenance? This big thing over prosperity is about the character of God. Do you know God? Do you trust God? Do you work the law of his investment? I was speaking for David Cirillo some weeks ago on Inspiration Network, and I had an extra hour between now and the time we flew out, and so I called my top 10 partners. I called my top 10 partners. And I said, meet me for 1 hour. They met. I walk in the room. Pastor Bob Rogers, I walked in the room and there was 2 girls, one about 18, one 19, 2 elderly men, and I looked around and these were my top partners in Charlotte, North Carolina, and I have hundreds, but they were my top ones. When I sat down, the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, they are your investors. They've invested in your vision. They've invested in you. They believe in you. They believe in the vision. Then the Lord began to talk to me. Do you know how much I've invested in you? Do you have any idea how I want to bless you? A man walked up one night and he said, you said God gave you a lifetime income from a one-time seed. I said, yes. He planted a faith promise. He said, as God provides, I'll plant an $8,500 seed. 12 months later, all of his gas wells that had been plugged up and stopped, they went back and found every one of them. He looked at me 1 year later and says, I have no idea how much I'm worth today because of that seed. That seed. I was in Costa Rica, and I was telling how I had broken the back of poverty with a $1,000 seed. And a man and his wife started walking to the pulpit. And the pastor behind me said, it's legitimate, let him come. The man and his wife got on the platform and said, 2 years ago, Mike Murdoch came to Costa Rica right here at this church. He said he had broken the back of poverty with a $1,000 seed. He said, I was in bankruptcy. I had lost my business. And I said, what do I have to lose? I'll go ahead and plant one more seed. He said, that was 2 years ago. He said, today I have five businesses. I just sold the first one 2 weeks ago for $160 million. He said, I'm going to sell the other four because I've decided to go into the ministry and pastor a church. How many think $160 million is a good amount to start your church with? Expectation. 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 I was in Jerusalem a few weeks back, and a young man rushed in the room in the private where I was speaking for Apostle Rene Terranova from the Amazon, Manaus. He rushed in. He said, I heard you was here. He said, where's it Hugo Chavez? Is that Venezuela? Venezuela. He rushed in. He said, I want to tell you. He said, in 2007, you told me to plant a seed and expect God to become a partner with me and to do business through me. He said, I'm not here but to meet with the government of Israel. And he starts flipping the pages, showing me the governments he's in business with. One of them, Hugo Chavez, he and his father, they supply cattle all over the world. And he said, that was 2007. And he said, I want you to look. He said, God has blessed me supernaturally. And it was because you told me to plant that seed. Every night I share this, I think of the pastor and his wife who received $100 million 30 days after they planted their first $1,000 seed that ever planted in New York City. God wants you to work with your expectations. Work with your expectations. I've asked the Lord to raise up 300 millionaires under my ministry. We have 28 at this time. I wish I could tell you their stories. Supernatural. Supernatural. So when I tell you that tonight's the poorest you will ever be, get excited. I said, get excited. Tonight is the poorest you will ever be. We have a Jehovah Jireh in our life. Bishop T.D. Jakes has planted thousands of dollars in my life. I turned to him one night while I was preaching at Potter's House. I said, Bishop, has anybody ever given you $1 million? He said, never. I said, money follows me everywhere I go. I said, I'm going to lay hands on you, and somebody's going to give you $1 million. He said, nobody had ever given him $1 million. Church went crazy. They was all shouting. 30 days later, his office called and said, Bishop said to tell Brother Mike, one of the Dallas Cowboy players has just planted his first $1 million seed. Remember your friend Barry? I don't know if he still pastors in Knoxville, but he used to work here at the church for your father. Remember that? One night, I turned around to him and I said, Barry, has anybody ever given you $1 million? He said, never. You have to know his country way. I said, I'm going to anoint you with oil, and somebody's going to give you $1 million. In his country voice, when I got through, he said, told his people. He had about 75 people on Wednesday night. He said, I hope this thing works. We need some money around here. T. 2 weeks later, a couple vacationing from California sat on the back seat of his church, and when his ushers counted the offering, one of the checks in that little Wednesday night offering of 50 to 75 people was $400,000. 2 weeks later, they called him and said, "Pastor, we just overnighted, FedEx or UPS, overnighted a little package. Open it and call us when it arrives." And when he opened the package, there was a cashier's check for $1 million. Tonight's the poorest you will ever be the rest of your life. If money will not make you backslide, and you promise not to backslide if God blesses you supernaturally, stand to your feet. If you say, "Mike, if God double my salary, I promise not to backslide." Now, if you think you'll backslide, stay seated so we can understand you. Lift up both hands high and say, "I will master the art of receiving. I will master the art of receiving." Oh, say it again. "I will master the art of receiving." I never trivialize the character of God. Begin to thank God for being the father you always wished you had. Thank him right now for loving you, for caring for you. Thank him for protecting you. Thank him for providing you. You said it for you. You sitting there at your house, you're watching through television, or you're watching on the internet, right where you're sitting, right there on the sofa, the recliner, both hands are to be up right now. Thank you, Father. I trust your nature. I trust your nature. I trust you. You are more than enough for me. You are my source. You are my supplier. You are my Jehovah Jireh. Oh, lift your voice. Don't mumble in your beard. Lift your voice aloud. You're good to me. You're a great God. You're a great God to me. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for his character right now. Lord, you're so good. We had someone. Can somebody help me on the electric piano over here? Can somebody, if we have one of the musicians of the church, just come and sit here for a few moments with me? Thank you, my brother. I'll give you a free book, whatever it takes. Just wave both hands. Say, "I'm a receiver. I'm a joyful receiver. I'm a happy receiver." Hallelujah. What a privilege to enter. Do you know the song, "God, You're So Good"? God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good. I watched you tonight. It won't be long. You'll be good, son. I think he's got a future in singing. I think he's got a future. Somewhere, God's gonna give it to him. I love that tonight. God, you're so good. 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 In a few moments, I want every person in this room that will enter into a new covenant with God in 2012. See if I won't open the windows of heaven. If 1,000 is all you'll ever want, keep it. But if your dream is bigger, enter into a covenant. It may take you 30 days. It may take you 90 days. But I feel so strongly that every person who enters into this covenant with God, I call it the Boaz anointing. That every time God blesses me, he blesses you. How many wish every time God gave me a Mercedes, he'd give you one? I'd like to tell you about the three jets that God gave me. How many, if God gave you a jet, you would brag too, just like I do? Wave a hand at me. How many right now is just working on your bicycle faith? You said, Mike, I'm at the bicycle level. Just say, I'm a receiver. Say it again, I'm a receiver. Say it aloud, I am a receiver. I am a receiver. Ecstasy is finding somebody who trusts you. Ecstasy is finding someone who trusts you. And God says, if I find you trusting me, I will open the windows of heaven. I will pour you out a blessing you do not have room enough to receive. Stretch forth your hand toward me. I'm going to ask, when I get through praying, for every person in this room, whether you sow it tonight or you sow it within 90 days, every person who say, I enter into a financial partnership with God for 2012. And I seal this in just a few moments. Our pastor, our ministers are going to lay hands on you. Just say it again, I'm a receiver. Oh, say it again, I am a receiver. I am a receiver. I am a receiver. When I finish my prayer, I'm going to pray for three harvests. One is that God will give you 12 months of perfect health. No sickness, no disease, no knife shall be put to your body. How many would like for healing to flow through your home for 12 months? No sickness, no disease. Isaiah 58, he said your health will spring forth speedily. Number two, a sevenfold return of anything that's ever been stolen from you. Wherever there's been robbery in your life, where somebody has taken from you, God said he'll return it sevenfold. Sevenfold. And then I believe in a financial Boaz. You're one person away from your next season. Your next season begins one person from now. Do you know Miles Monroe? How many of you ever heard of Miles Monroe? We traveled a lot of miles together preaching. We were on our way to Ghana, and we was in England airport, and we were sitting there. People had already got on the plane. He and I were last, and suddenly a man walks through the gate, and he said, you know who that is? I said, no. He said, he's the third greatest soccer player in the world. I don't follow soccer, so I didn't know the guy, and he came over there to hug Miles. Miles said, I want you to meet my friend Mike Murdoch. And he said, oh, I got all your books. He said, hold on, I'll be right back. He came back in, and this was when 5 pounds was worth $10. A 20 pound was worth 40, twice what American dollar. And he had a big bag about this big, about this much. And he said, I can't be around you without sowing. And he starts handing me these chunks of money. So I'm putting them in my pocket. Everybody's on the plane. I put them in my briefcase, and I look like Eddie Murphy, you know? Remember that movie? And I start, and I thought, they're going to think I'm a drug dealer just as sure as the world. I was all puffed out with all these stacks of money. And the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, I can get money to you anywhere you are. I can get money to you anywhere you are. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Our Jehovah Jireh can get us money anywhere we are. Anywhere we are. Stretch forth your hand toward me. Father, I set myself in agreement all across this room. All across this room, I ask you within 90 days to provide a supernatural seed to sow. Some have it tonight. Some can sow it before they leave. Some will sow it in 3 weeks. Some will sow it in 6 weeks. But we enter into a financial covenant for 2012. There's 5 people watching me right now through television and streaming live that you are stirring them up. You're stirring them up because their dream is bigger than 1,000. 1,000's not enough for their dream, but it's enough to birth a partnership. I ask you for 3 harvests in 2012. I ask you for 12 months of perfect health and healing for every member of their family. A sevenfold return of whatever has been taken from them. And then put a financial Boaz in their life. Put one person in their life who decides to bless them. One person who will make an investment in them. One person who believes they're worthy of investing. I call in the 100-fold. I call in the 1,000-fold of Deuteronomy 1. In the name of Jesus.
Father, we're not only seed sowers, but we are masters at receiving. In Jesus' name, I want every person in this room who will enter into a new covenant with God and say within 90 days, God will receive a $1,000 seed from me for 2012. Get out of your seat fast. Get out of your seat fast, quickly. Don't wait for anybody. Don't wait for anybody. Move quickly. Move quickly. He said, I'll give seed to a sower. Come as close as you can. He said, I'll give seed to a sower. I will give seed to a sower. I will give seed to a sower. A thousand's not enough. You can't even buy a car with a thousand. Get out of your seat. It's not enough. If a thousand satisfied your dreams and your needs, I'd say keep your thousand. But we have a Jehovah Jireh. A thousand's not enough to make a difference in your spending, but it's enough to make a difference in our covenant with God. There's five people sitting there at your house. I see the number five. I don't know your name. I don't know your address. But there's five people that's viewing this, and I hope we re-air this, because you need a harvest much more than you need the thousand. A thousand's not enough. A thousand's not enough to be a harvest. And if what you have is not enough to be your harvest, you turn it into a seed. There's others. Would you come close as you can? Because I'm going to ask God for a Boaz anointing, that every time he blesses me, he blesses you. Hallelujah. 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 Today's the poorest I will ever be the rest of my life. Somebody else supposed to be up here. Quickly come. Quickly come. This may not happen for another 2 or 3 years in your life. God may not give you this kind of faith. God may not give you this kind of faith for another 2 or 3 years. I want my pastor to join me in just a moment. I want everybody to receive a special envelope. Everybody, even back in the audience. Because some of us don't have the thousand, but we've got $100 to sow. We've got $50 to sow. We've got $200 to sow. Every one of us, Pastor, every one of us will sow a seed at some level. Just wave your envelope to God and say, you are my financial partner. Little lower on the volume. Lower on the volume. Lower on the volume. Just wave your seed. Wave your seed. Say, Father, thank you for being my financial partner. Say it again. Thank you for being my financial partner. Oh, wave it high. Thank you for being my financial partner. Hallelujah. Pray this prayer in the name of Jesus. I wrap expectation around this seed. Father, you gave me seed to sow. Tonight, I bring it back to you for 100-fold return. Maximum yield. I am a receiver. I am a receiver of divine health. I am a receiver of a 7-fold return of everything Satan has stolen. In the name of Jesus, I call in a financial Boaz to my life. Father, I thank you. I thank you. I will have a testimony in 2012 as the most significant year of my life. This is my year for prosperity. This is my year for prosperity. This is my year for prosperity. Now lift the other hand high and just say, I receive, I receive, I receive. Oh, say it again. I receive, I receive, I receive. I decided to be a receiver. I decided to be a receiver. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Before you anoint, I just feel like there's somebody I want to pray for. Is this anointing oil? Would you mind opening that for me? 2.5 years ago, I entered one of the most difficult zones of my life, the worst period of my lifetime for 2 years. The worst zone of my life. I became so disheartened with people, disheartened with where I had planted, and I felt like all of my work was in vain. People that I had taught, I didn't see change. Did you ever go through anything like that where you poured yourself into somebody and they didn't change? That ever happened to you? I should have called you. I thought I would die. I thought I would die. I lost all desire for everything. And during that time, I was building. I decided to build an extra bedroom to my home. And it turned out to be a huge addition. And I'm out there feeling so, I said, this is nuts. This is crazy. Why would I build something this nice for me? And so I'm walking out and I said, Lord, if this is not you. And he spoke back to me. He said, "You, this is world class to you. You think this is special? You think this is extra classy?" And he just talked to me like I talked to you. He said, "You have no idea my taste level." You know Buck Avanzini, John's son. Buck had brought to me a proposal for all the wood in that addition. The addition was 5,600 feet. That's almost like a house, isn't it? 55,600 feet from my bedroom. And he brought me a proposal, and I looked at the proposal and shook my head. It was a huge amount of money. A huge. An odd amount, huge. And I said, God, this is nuts. And I felt the release. Let him go ahead. I flew to England. When I got through teaching, I never signed books, but the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, tell him you'll sign, I think, for 10 minutes. I'd sign books in the back. 10,000 people. They're for Bishop Matthew. You know Matthew Ashmore. I said, I'm going to sign books for 10, 15 minutes, and then I'm gone. When I get through signing books, I'm walking through the crowd, 10,000 people, and a man comes up to me, doesn't say a word, hugs me and smiles. Ron Bowman. Ron, would you wave a hand? He and his wife. Ron Bowman comes in a little room where I am a few minutes later and said, the man that just hugged you said to give you this. And it was a stack of $100 bills that equaled the exact amount of Buck Avanzini's proposal for that 5,600 square feet. Shoot, I'm not going to tell you any more miracles. Is there just one happy? God bless you. Thank you for being happy. Say, I'm happy for you. What's the chances in 10,000 people of a man coming face to face with you and handing you a stack of $100 bills? It is an absolute miracle. And it was an odd number. Odd number. And it paid for all the wood in 5,600 square feet of a bedroom. To anoint eight before you start the prayer line. Eight for a lifetime income. Every time I anoint someone for the $8,500 seed, there's a supernatural grace comes upon their life. Their business flourishes, their investments flourish, and I don't want to leave Louisville until I anoint at least eight. There may be more, but eight's the number of new beginnings. Eight to plant a seed of $8,500. In his house. Just say his house. Stretch forth your hand toward me. Father, your sheep know your voice and another will not follow. Tonight may be the only time in our lifetime that any man of God ever comes into a covenant for a lifetime income. You gave me a lifetime blessing from a one-time seed of $8,500. We've seen oil wells, gas wells. We've seen so many things happen because of this new level of covenant. And in this room, as I anoint with oil, eight. And Father, I feel like all eight will walk in obedience tonight. as I anoint them with oil, let this be the beginning of the happiest breakthrough year of 2012 they've ever had. There are two people watching on the internet, watching on television, that could easily plant this seed. But they're scared. They're scared of the economy. Remind them that everything good comes from you. As I anoint these with oil, everything you do for me, do for them. I decree it so. In the name of Jesus, if you're one of the eight to plant a seed of 8,500, I want you to come into covenant quickly. Come up on the platform first, quickly. Move past anybody and come stand with me here. Hallelujah. I'm so glad. I'm so glad. You have a grace on you for this. Hallelujah. Quickly come. Quickly come. Don't wait for anybody else. Quickly come. Quickly come. I remember when I thought 8,500 was huge. But if you've got big dreams, how many have a dream a lot bigger than 8,500? A lot bigger than 8,500. There's eight I want to anoint with oil. Hallelujah. You're together. One, two, three, four. Who's the other four? Quickly come. Quickly come. Are you one of them, Pastor? Five. Oh, you wait for this year. This is going to be the year. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Would you come? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Never negotiate with the Holy Spirit. Never argue with the Holy Spirit. Never argue with the Holy Spirit. If you're supposed to be up here, quickly, I think there's two more. Quickly come, quickly come. You need the harvest a lot more than you need the 8,500. You're wise, you're wise, you're wise. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Somebody else has faith too. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Who else is supposed to be up here? You say, well, they've got the eight, but I'm supposed to be up there too. Anybody else? Quickly come if you're supposed to be up here. Quickly come. God bless you, my brother. God bless you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Tonight's the poorest you will ever be. I said, tonight is the poorest you will ever be. Tonight is the poorest you will ever be. Tonight is the poorest you will ever be. We have a Jehovah Jireh. We have a Jehovah Jireh. Hallelujah. There's two people watching right now, sitting there in your home, on your recliner, your sofa. There's one person in a bed, and the Spirit of God is churning in you. You said, God, I have a dream a lot bigger than 8,500. Then enter into this lifetime blessing covenant. Enter into this lifetime blessing. Everybody say lifetime blessing. Lifetime. Say it again. Lifetime. Say it again. Lifetime. Say it again. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Who else is supposed to be here? Who else is supposed to be here? Quickly come. This may not happen for another 5 years. Hallelujah. This may not happen for another 5 years. If you're supposed to be standing up here, would you come? I want my three gentlemen that work in my ministry. Marquez, would you come? Pastor Ron Bowman, would you come? Michael, would you come? And I want you to stand behind these and just say, I enter into a covenant. Yes, yes, yes. Some of you want to move some funds around. You've got an investment, and you're going to move some things around even in the next 90 days. You get up here. Get up here. Even if it takes you 90 days to complete this 8,500, get out of your seat. Get out of your seat. Come up here. You may have to move some things around. But there's something supernatural about this grace. Say, I will master the art of receiving. Hallelujah. I will master the art of receiving. Hallelujah. I will master the art of receiving. There's someone here's got some land, some real estate for sale. And you're saying, if it's sold in 90 days, I'd do it. Now's the time to make the step. Now's the time to say, I'm in covenant with God. I'm trying to sell a house. I'm trying to sell some property. I enter into a covenant with God. I wouldn't stay in this economy without the Jehovah Jireh in my life. I said, I wouldn't stay in this economy without the Jehovah Jireh in my life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Pastor, would you come with me? Hallelujah. Put out both hands. These hands are blessed, and everything you touch will prosper, and favor will grow where there's never been favor. Great peace will come upon you. These hands are blessed. Say, I'm a receiver of a lifetime blessing. There's a whole lot you got coming that's never come to you. There's been an interception of the blessing of God on your life. Hell has dreaded to see the happiness in your life. Hell has fought you like he's fought few men. But you have a lifetime blessing. We enter into a covenant. Hallelujah. Say, I'm in covenant with the Most High God. I am a receiver of the lifetime covenant. All the days of my life, I will prosper. My family shall prosper. Hallelujah. Man of God. God has put the prophetess in your bosom, and the words that she will speak to you will be words that bless and not hurt. They will be wise words, and they will bring great balance in every investment of your life. Hallelujah. God put your face so much in front of me tonight while you were sitting here. I set myself in covenant that while you have watched others be blessed, now it's going to start a whole level of testimony for your life. I sanctify this seat as holy and righteous. I declare a lifetime blessing upon everything that you put your hand to. I see some jealous relatives. I see some jealous relatives because God's going to show off. God's going to show off. God's going to show off. God's going to show you off as a trophy on display. As a trophy on display. God's going to show you off. I sanctify this seat as holy. I sanctify this seat as righteous. There are three people that's not standing on this platform that should be here in the next 60 seconds. There are three people that should be on this platform to receive this anointing, this grace, and God's asking you for a new level. Move with it. A lifetime blessing. Life, don't fear. Don't fear. The God who gives you the seed is responsible for the harvest. He said, I'll give seed to a sower, but I give a harvest to a receiver. Hallelujah. There's not a greedy bone in your body, and God sees it. I call in everything that Satan has stolen. Times seven. A sevenfold return of everything that Satan has taken from you. A lifetime blessing begins now upon your life. A lifetime blessing in Jesus' name. Oh, Father, she's got incredible faith. There are people in her life that think she's not logical enough. But her faith is at work. She's decided to live a higher realm. She has world-class style, world-class taste, and she serves a world-class God. Never be ashamed of the level God's bringing you. Never be ashamed. This kind of seed is a conversation with God. I declare a lifetime blessing upon everything that you put your hand to. Lifetime blessing. Lifetime blessing. The work of your hands will prosper. And everything that you put your hand to, everything you put your hand to, say, I'm a master at receiving. Say it out loud. I'm a master at receiving. Hallelujah. Father, she has been so smitten in her mind. She's been criticized by people for wanting the best life. There have been times that words have entered her like a knife. Words have entered her like a knife from people she loved, people whose approval she wanted. Tonight it changes. She's the daughter of the King, the Most High God. I sanctify this seed as the beginning of the happiest 2012, the happiest year of your lifetime. There will be no burden and no stress. Father, I anoint him that the same anointing that's on my life put upon him. He is the kind that's not afraid of anybody. So he will give his testimony. He will shout. He will give you the glory. And he will remember this night as a significant seed. Hallelujah. You are a receiver. You are a receiver. You will master the art of receiving. God hasn't created you to adapt to lack. God created you to multiply. And you know that in your heart. I sanctify this seed as holy, as righteous. I sanctify this seed as the beginning of the glorious years of your life. And do not fear. Do not be afraid to dream bigger and bigger. God's going to give you a dream that makes you use your faith. Hallelujah. Father, give him a lifetime blessing, that his family will never lack for the rest of his days. Boy, there's blessing all over this family, isn't it? There's blessing all over this family. She your wife? She is as nice as what she looks? She's a fireball, isn't she? She's a fireball. She's going to tell you what she thinks, isn't she? And you're going to sort through it. She's got faith, man. She don't only have faith in God, she has faith in you. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Look at me for a moment. Faith works. Faith works. Faith works. Faith. We took a picture today, didn't we, together? I release the lifetime blessing. I release the lifetime blessing on everything that you put your hand to. Father, he is not afraid to enter the future in partnership with you. And everything that his hands touch, expose every deceptive voice in his environment. Expose every deceptive voice in his environment. And his decisions will be perfect decisions. I feel like every person right now, if you'll lift up both hands and say, I will make perfect decisions in the name of Jesus. If you say that over and over, there will be a faith rise in your heart. I will make perfect decisions. I will make perfect decisions. My decisions will birth blessing. My decisions will birth blessing. My decisions will birth blessing. I set myself in covenant for a lifetime blessing. Lifetime blessing, and you will never forget tonight as long as you live. You trusted some wrong people. You just trusted some wrong people. You thought some people would come through what they said. But this is a new day, 2012. You're trusting the right person. The Spirit of the living God will not forsake you. He will not forsake you. Don't be afraid of the new decision making, because God is at a new level in your life. Sir, God is at a new level in your life, and there's going to be a knowing like nothing you've ever known. Hallelujah. There have been times in your life when people have blessed you and they've given you things, whether it's rings or watches or whatever it is. There's times that people walked up to you and blessed you. But there's never been a year like this year. Hallelujah. As the queen of God's work, get ready to receive. I want you to master the art of receiving. Master the art of receiving. There's going to be people come up to you and say, God told me to give you $1,000. God told me to give you $500. God told me to give you $200. There's going to be the most strangest kind of blessing. And everybody who sows into you, they will double in the financial anointing on their life, because the quality of the soil determines the future of the seed. In Jesus' name. Say it aloud, I will master the art of receiving. And when somebody comes up to bless you, don't ever say you don't have to do that, because their anointing will double because of the quality soil. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is going to take a load off of you. This is going to take a load off of you. Obria sevi kasaha. La da da la bokoshe kevi ambrasa. Seed multiply. Seed multiply. I come into agreement with you that everything you touch is blessed. There's a new day. 2012 is unlike any other year of your whole lifetime. Hallelujah. Boy, I like your look. I've watched in service tonight. Don't he have a good look? Does he always look smiling like this? Wow. Wow. Father, this sense of trustworthiness in his life, where other people trust him, let like a Joseph, let that mantle multiply until the voices in high places want to hear his opinion. Lord, let the trustworthiness be sealed and stabilized in everything that he touches. A lifetime blessing upon his life. A lifetime blessing. It don't take everybody liking you, just the right person liking you. I'm a receiver. Oh, say that again.
I am a receiver.
Say it loud.
I am a receiver.
Everybody say, I am a receiver. He's wise, Father, not to allow another year to go by without a new level of his faith. I sanctify this seed as holy for your house. And what he makes happen for your house, what he makes happen for your house, you will make happen for his house. He is a receiver. Everything you do for me, do for him, Lord. Everything you do for me, do for him. Remove every ounce of fear he has had. Lord, he's had some losses in his life that made him fearful. He's had some losses in his life that makes him a little slow on some decisions. But this is a new year. It's a new level of his faith. And 2012 is the year he has wanted and longed for. I'm a receiver. I am a receiver. Hallelujah. 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 Pastor, you're about to hear the greatest testimonies you've ever heard in your life. Hallelujah. I don't know of anyone I'd rather anoint me with oil than Dr. Bob Rogers. And all over the world, he has laid hands on people. And there's been... Never let familiarity, never ever let familiarity become common to you. There are preachers all around the world that would give anything to have 15 minutes with your pastor. They would pay any price. They would pay any price. There's preachers all across the world trying to get to him. If they could just have one conversation with him. Just say, I'm a receiver of the anointing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Pastor, I've taken up so much time tonight, but I see glory all over this house. Let me just tell you, get ready for good things. I'm a receiver. I'm a receiver. Just do this. I'm a receiver. Say it again. I'm a receiver. How many promise to brag just like I do? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I had some preachers come to me after a conference, and they gathered around and said, Brother Mike, we've been talking. We feel like you should be very careful about telling people all your blessings. I said, and what's made you think I've told them all? What on earth has made you think? I haven't even met a human yet that I'm ready to tell everything God has done for me. I haven't even met one human that I'm ready to tell everything God has done for me. But he has. He is our Jehovah Jireh. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Oh, I sense the presence of the Lord here, don't you? You may return to your seats. In just a few minutes, we're going to begin to lay hands. I'm going to ask Brother Murdoch and his team to join us along with our pastors. We're going to ask the ushers to come now. We're going to receive the offering tonight. And I'm going to ask you to fill out that card, the envelope, and put your check inside. If you need a little bit for that money to come in, some of you have planted in faith. God will send it in. We're going to believe over the next 90 days. that will come in. But I ask you to do something. Put something in there to activate your gift. Activate that pledge. It may be $100, it may be $1,000, it may be $50, it may be any amount. But if you'll do the best you can, it begins to activate that in the name of the Lord. Has this been a tremendous, tremendous so far? Hallelujah. I want to give everyone plenty of time to fill out that envelope. When you have it filled out, would you just hold it up to the Lord so we can know? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You know, in all of the ministry that we do, we have 22 services on a Sunday. And God has given us another building. We're in the process of getting the paper signed and so forth. But this building that God is giving us is better than any, it's nicer than any buildings that we have. It's over in Indiana. It has a huge gymnasium, a big kitchen. It's got two auditoriums in it. It's got over 35 Sunday school rooms, and could have a great school there. And we are getting it for about half the price. They're financing it for about half the price of what we would have. The place we have over there, the payments are going to be less than that. And God is sending us a buyer for the place we have. And they're buying it from us in a lease purchase. And it looks like it's going to be almost $1,000 more than our payments on that one building. So, I mean, how many know that is the grace and favor of the Lord? Hallelujah. And the church there is multiplying. Evangel North is multiplying. And we praise the Lord for that. We bought a building, the Premier Fitness Center. We bought that building right there by the Bass Pro Shop. It's appraised now at 1.2, and we owe $600,000 on it. And that just shows the grace of the Lord and how that church is multiplying. That's what God's grace is on us here tonight. Hold that offering high. Let's pray together. Say, Lord Jesus, I'm believing you for breakthroughs this year, for blessings in my family and in my home. In Jesus' name, amen. I want you to give tonight. Go ahead, ushers, if you'll pass that. Now, as we're passing this, I want to share just a moment what we're going to do. In just a few minutes, we're going to have a double prayer line here. You will walk through this prayer line, and these men and women will anoint you with oil. They'll pray over you. And as you go through there, I want you to go through with your faith focused on what you're believing God to do for you. And we're believing that this God is going to seal what is taking place on this fast, what God has a promise that he's going to do. God gave me a promise at the beginning of this fast. It was in Isaiah 44:3. I will pour water upon them that are thirsty and floods upon the dry ground. And I pour my spirit on your seed and my blessing upon your offspring. This is a blessing. This is an anointing that God's going to release on families in the name of the Lord. When John the Baptist came, the prophecy came to his father Zechariah that he would have the spirit of Elijah upon him and he would turn the hearts of the sons to their fathers. I believe that John the Baptist preached on the home and preached on the healing of families. This is what God's going to do in the name of Jesus. I want our pastors to come. I want you to form two lines right here. I want you to come very quickly. I want our deacons, I want you to come and join these in a line, a double line. And I want those who are believing for miracles in your home. Your home has been under some fiery attack of the enemy. Stand to your feet, go to the back of the auditorium. go around to the left all the way over here and form a single line right over here to my left. Go very quickly. Move on around, all right around the wall. Right around the wall. Ushers, help me. Right around the wall. Secondly, I want those who have been under some physical attack in your body. You're believing God for a healing. I want you to get up, and I want you to join them in that line. Move very quickly. Move very quickly on around. Thirdly, I'm asking everyone else to get in line behind these. So those on this section, if you'll stand up, if you'll move to the back of the auditorium, those on these other areas, wait till that line begins to go around, and then you may begin to join in that line. Hallelujah. I want us to pray this prayer together. Say, Lord Jesus, thank you for the presence of the Holy Spirit. As hands are laid upon me this evening, may there be a release of your miracle power and your miracle anointing in my life. 2012 will be a prosperous year for me. Everything the devil's told me, the opposite will come to pass. The devil's a liar and has no rights over my family nor the lives of my children. In Jesus' name, I receive the miracle tonight for the glory of God. I want you to begin to come now.
You hold my head.
Trust you, Lord, and I trust.